Well, I'd like to welcome everyone. We forgot the box for me to stand on, but hopefully you can more or less see me. I'd like to welcome you and thank you for coming. You honor Ray with your presence. Just being here is a tribute to him, to who he was, and we'll be channeling him today. We already have him in the room, in a way, with the pictures. System is off.
Oh, there we go. Here we go. Yeah.
Okay. Does that help? Just to speak more into the microphone? Okay. All right. We have a whole bunch of family here, and Ray was the consummate family man. Family was incredibly important to him, and we spent a lot of time together as a blended family. And so I would like to introduce the family members and have them stand up as I say their names. I'm going to do this in chronological order. I've got a chronological structure here. So the firstborn is Karen. And Karen is over here. Karen is a clinical social worker. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. And she was absolutely the apple of her father's eye. She's the clinical director for a mental health agency in Birmingham, Alabama. Next in line is my son, Jim. Jim is in San Diego. He owns his own business. He has the Good Earth and Greenscaped Buildings in San Diego. Next in line would be Derek. Derek is with United Airlines, and he lives in Florida. And his wife, Valerie, couldn't be with us today. She's at home in Dunedin, where they are. The next in line is Michael. Michael, over here at the corner. Michael owns his own business. We have two entrepreneurs in the family, Jim and Michael. Michael owns Fowler Communications and works in Birmingham, along with his beautiful wife, Sharon. Thank you. And last but not least, of course, is my daughter, Monica, who is our youngest. Monica lives in Arvada, Colorado. She's a human resources specialist and personnel manager, and her husband, Scott, is with her today. And Scott is an international tax director for Terumo, a Japanese-owned company. So those are the kids, the offspring. We have grandchildren with us today. We had the five kids, believe it or not, our five children are between the ages of 55 and 58. 3 years for five kids. None of them are twins. So then we have five grandchildren as well. And so once again, we'll go in chronological order. The firstborn grandchild was Katie. Katie Somerville, who has just gotten a master's in public administration, a wonderful job, and she just added a new person to the family, her husband, Robert Somerville. They were married. He is an entrepreneur and a contractor. He is, the two of them live in Marengo County in Alabama. The next in line would be Theodore, my grandson, who just climbed Mount Shasta and is not with us here today, but he successfully made it to the peak and down again. That was the most important part. He got down again. Next in line is Cade, Karen's son. Cade just graduated from high school, and he's going to be entering UAB in the fall, University of Alabama at Birmingham in the fall, and he's going to be going into a nursing program. So, a good choice. Next is Allie, Alexandra, who is my namesake. Her mother is Greek, and so Alexandra is the Greek form of Sandra. She just ended her junior year. She goes into her senior year next year in San Diego at Granite Hills High. The youngest grandchild could not be with us today either. His name is Sam. He's Deck's son. Sam is our computer guru. He is not just a computer geek, he is a guru. And so anybody who has computer problems can go to Sam and get them straightened out. I'd like to mention that each of the men in the family has on a tie that belonged to Ray. And actually, you've probably seen some of them in the pictures that we have. I would like to remind people that I have a remembrance book out there. In fact, we have two. So if you want to write as much as you want to write, put it in there. We'll get the other book out so that there's plenty of space for you to go ahead and write. It's in on a table at the back wall if you haven't seen it yet. I would like to say that the program today, which is not in your remembrance brochure, but the program came to me when, and Mike and I worked on it together, actually, when I was talking to my dearest friend in Washington, Fanchon Silverstein, who happens to be here too, and she was talking to me about a Quaker ceremony that she went to for a Foreign Service colleague. And she said that they had a few speakers, and unfortunately, one of them just droned on and on and on. Well, we do have some speakers today, but none of them are going to drone. We made sure of that. And at the end, we will have what Fanchon calls a bubble-up time. So anything that bubbles up to you about Ray, about your experience of him, what kind of a person you thought he was, just anything, if it bubbles up, we invite you to share during the bubble-up time. And before I turn the program over to the manager of communication today, our MC, which is going to be Norman Anderson, who took over the reins when Ray retired as CEO, I need to say something about three very special people to Ray. So I'm sort of channeling Ray now. I know that he would want this said if he were here. When he arrived over on 17th Street to take over the CEO position from Gary Vandenbos, who is here, and Gary had been handling the job really very well, but he came in to take over, and he looked around. The executive office space at that time was maybe slightly larger than this room, but it wasn't very big, and he looked around. He found Judy Strasburger, and he said, "Judy, you're a miracle worker, but you're going to need help working the miracles that we need to put APA back on its feet," because it wasn't doing well when he took over. So he made two phone calls. I don't know which was the first one, and it doesn't matter. He called Mike Honecker in Florida. Mike was happily teaching at FIT, and he convinced Mike that he should absolutely come up to Washington and help him put APA back together. And Mike very graciously said yes, thinking a couple years at the most. He's still here. The other phone call was to Jack McKay. Jack had left APA. He had been the CFO. He had left APA. And Ray knew that in Jack's heart, he wanted to come back. And so he called him up and convinced him of that. And fortunately, because Jack was able to straighten out the finances as well. So you've got a nucleus here. The nucleus is Judy and Mike and Jack and Ray. And they, along with other staff members who were here as well, but they really created the possibility for APA to become as great as it did during the 13 years that Ray was CEO. So I wanted them to know how much Ray cared and how much it meant to him. And I wanted you to know too. So now I think I will turn it over to Norman to lead us through the rest of the program. And I thank you all for coming. Really very special to see all of you.
Thank you, Sandy, and good afternoon, everyone. It's great to see you here, and I think it's really fitting that this celebration of Ray's life is occurring in the APA building. It's really the building Ray built, the building Ray and Jack and others built. This is really this building is really a big part of Ray's legacy, and you'll hear more about his legacy as we go through the program. Some of you may know or may not know, this floor is the newest part of the building. It's only been open a little more than a year. But although it's new, this too is also part of Ray's legacy. Ray and Jack and others had a vision for some type of conference center on this floor and were completely prevented from doing that because of DC regulations. And fortunately, over the last few years, those regulations loosened a bit. And with a great team on our staff here now, we were able to put this together. So I just think it's a beautiful setting, particularly the way you all are looking out. It's a great place to reflect on Ray's life and accomplishments. It's really great to see so many family members here, friends, colleagues, former co-workers and others are here to celebrate his life. What we want to do to start this part of the session is really a special feature. Many of you know that Ray had a massive stroke in 2010, in December 2010, and Ray lost his ability to speak. Fortunately, not his ability to smile, which is a beautiful smile. But in July of last year, Ray, with Sandy's help, was able to record a special greeting to the International Congress of Applied Psychology, ICAP, which was one of Ray's favorite organizations. And that conference occurred July 2014 in Paris, France. And with Sandy's help, I understand across several months, Ray was able to give a verbal greeting to that assembled body during the opening ceremony. And we have a short video to show you that.
Hello, hello, hello. My name is Ray Fowler. Welcome to ICAP.
Thank you. So now we're ready to have some individual tributes about Ray's life. And I'm going to start by reading a special tribute from Dr. Jack Wiggins, who is the 1992 centennial president of the American Psychological Association. Jack was supposed to be here to do this himself, but was unable to attend. So I'm going to read his remarks. His remarks are a little bit longer, but I think they provide a good context, a good historical context for the rest of the afternoon. So again, this is from Dr. Jack Wiggins, 1992 APA president. This tribute to Dr. Raymond D. Fowler is for his lifetime of achievements. We were friends and colleagues in APA for over 30 years. Ray will long be remembered for his administrative leadership as CEO of the American Psychological Association. His leadership in growing an organization with less than 50,000 members in a 16,000 square foot building into a 150,000 member organization with two large buildings that APA became before he retired is a story worth recalling. From 1982, when Ray became treasurer of APA, until he retired as CEO in 2003 is a two-decade history of expansion of APA that is not likely to be repeated. It is recited here for those unfamiliar with the history of APA and Ray's political acumen in leading a professional staff to work well together. Ray and I met as members of the APA Council of Representatives and shared our mutual interest in the MMPI. We worked together on professional issues at APA, such as the licensing of psychologists with an organization called CAPS, that's an acronym, an advocacy group for practice called the Dirty Dozen. CAPS supported the election, his election as APA treasurer. Once elected, Ray found sufficient challenges to occupy his many skills. APA's council had purchased the popular magazine, Psychology Today, and found that managing a commercial enterprise at a financial loss was unsustainable despite its publishing profitable professional journals. This resulted in the sale of its building on 16th Street and a search for new headquarters. The growth of APA's membership through state licensure of practitioners was a major part of its return to financial solvency. However, this growth of licensed practitioners, partly supported by APA funds, created competition with science and education constituents within the organization. External advocacy by CAPS had effectively advanced psychology as a full-service licensed mental health profession recognized by federal courts. The demand for equal sharing of membership money for advocacy resulted in a new multi-constituency advocacy organization called acronym AAP under the wings of APA. Instead of mollifying the competing groups, this action served to empower and fund the differing groups to vote on whether to remain. The decisiveness came to a head as Ray became APA president. So Ray was treasurer, then he was elected president of APA. A referendum was held for members to vote on whether to remain as members of APA or join a new science organization or become members of both groups. To Ray's credit, the results were clearly in favor of remaining within APA. Those favoring a science membership organization joined the Association of Psychological Science, but with Ray's leadership, maintained their membership in APA as well. The groundbreaking of the new APA building at 750 First Street Northeast, where we are, marked the beginning of the new era of psychology as a full-fledged health profession with its multifaceted science basis. Planning and moving APA offices into the new building next to Union Station went well. The APA headquarters were dedicated at a centennial celebration convention in 1992 that drew leading psychologists from around the world. Ray continued to be a leader in the international psychology community during the following 11 years with him as APA CEO. Ray and Sandy, his wife and contributing partner, were avid runners wherever they traveled. Ray's retirement left APA a legacy of financial stability and a vision of a dynamic future for its members. We are thankful for Ray sharing his vibrant, productive life with APA members and with the worldwide public that has gained handsomely from the expertise and services of psychologists. Again, from Dr. Jack Wiggins, 1992, APA president. I'd like to say a few words from my own perspective about Ray in three different areas, actually four, just briefly. The first time I met Ray was early 1990s, when I was a member of the Board of Scientific Affairs for APA. I didn't know much about Ray at the time, but those of you who've been to our various boards and committee meetings know that the CEO frequently goes around to the various boards and committees and spends time with them. And Ray came to the Board of Scientific Affairs, and I remember just being blown away by Ray. He was just so poised, you know, so smart, had such character. He was so articulate, and I remember sitting there thinking, I mean, that's the kind of leader that I want to be. I was just that really sticks out in my mind, seeing Ray come around to the BSA at that time. Much later, I got to know Ray a lot better once I was designated as CEO. Ray was still CEO. And so during the fall of 2002, while Ray was in his last few months as CEO, you know, I spent a great deal of time here in the building working with Ray. So we'd have daily, weekly meetings very frequently, where I'd come to Ray's office and he'd have a piece of paper, he'd have a copy, he'd hand me a copy, and it was just a list of bulleted topics, just one or two words. Things like APA Council, Board of Directors, Executive Staff, international organizations. And he'd just go through the list and just start talking, just downloading his considerable knowledge of each of those topics to me. And it was just a virtuoso performance that I wish I had recorded, because he just, as the kids, just riffed on every single aspect of APA. His knowledge was encyclopedic concerning APA, and that was so beneficial to me getting started. After Ray retired, I saw him, a lot less, but whenever I saw him, and Ray served on some of our committees during that time, sometimes he came to council, and we always were able to steal a little time together. And it was a really special bond, because I found Ray was the only person I could talk to who understood what I was going through, the challenges and the joys, the uplifts, the hassles of being CEO of a very large organization. And, we sit down together and Ray would smile and say, how's it going? And I just smiled back and we just both spontaneously started laughing because I didn't have to tell him how it was going. He knew exactly how it was going. He knew exactly what the CEO of APA deals with on a day-to-day basis. So it was just really fortunate to me to have someone like that in my life who I knew completely understood the job that I was trying to do and who I knew was always supportive of me. So that was really wonderful. The last thing I want to say is that many of you know the association does for our members, provides a very high award for our members called the Dr. Raymond D. Fowler Award, and that's given to one of our members, psychologists. What you might not know is we also have a Raymond D. Fowler Award for our staff. It is the highest award we give our staff at APA. And we give this at something called our all hands meetings. And I just want to show you, the name was customer service. This is when all, almost 600 of our staff. Raymond D. Fowler Award honors an APA staff member who exemplifies Ray. some of the extraordinary characteristics of Dr. Fowler. The award is our highest recognition for an APA staff member. And the nominees for this award come directly from the coworkers. This is not top down. Staff nominate each other, and we have a special committee that's run out of Mike Honecker's office, and they select the awardee. The nominations criteria are as follows. The recipient serves as a catalyst to enhance the overall collaborative processes across APA and all departments and governance groups. This person maintains a professional presence and demeanor that facilitates open, honest communication within and between groups, even when those groups have disparate ideas. And you recall Ray was very, very good at this. This award, the recipient promotes knowledge of and respect for diversity of opinions and backgrounds, and serves as an ambassador for the association by demonstrating a consistently high level of motivation for and commitment to doing a job well while promoting the ideals of the association. So again, we give one of these a year. These are our all staff meetings. We dress informally for these. That's why we see jeans on. Each recipient gets a check for $1,000, just like the member award. They get a certificate. And in some respects, the most valuable contribution, a most valuable aspect of this award is the black hat. You see, we're wearing these caps. Well, one year, we always give a little trinket or something at these meetings for staff. One year was caps, has APA logo on it. They came in different colors, but there were just a couple that were black. And because I guess they were so rare, everyone wanted a black one. And we said, well, we should make some black ones. And I think maybe it was even Mike Sotera's idea. I said, well, let's hold the black ones back and give those to the Raymond D. Fowler Award winners. And they are so valuable. Now, so these are just some of the people. This is not all the awardees. Some of the people you mentioned, Sarah Jordan received the Raymond D. Fowler Award most recently. Sarah, some of these folks are here. All of them are not here. Mary Campbell, who many of you know, won it in 2008. Emily Leary says won the award. Clinton Anderson, who's here, won the award. Brenda Evans, Joanne Zaslow, and Margie Bird, who's also here. That just gives you a flavor. Some of you may have worked with some of these folks in the past. I just wanted to let you see some of the people who received this high honor. And just in conclusion, this photo was made when I was coming in as CEO, Ray was leaving. This was actually at a nice event at Ray and Sandy's home in 2002. So since that time in 2002 through our last photo together, next to last photo together at Ray and Sandy's home in San Diego just a couple of years ago, I have to say Ray was really the most really supportive person in APA for me, and it was just an outstanding role model, and I'm just honored to have known him. So thank you very much for listening. So moving on, we've got several people who will be giving formal tributes, and then as Sandy mentioned, the rest of you will be able to say some things as well. So the next tribute is from Mike Honecker, who you've heard about. He's deputy CEO and is a former graduate student at Ray's. Mike.
You know, it was today I finally kind of experienced the enormity of this loss. So excuse me a little bit if my voice is kind of wavering, because it really kind of hit me today. Thank you, Sandy, for your comments. I mean, that meant a whole lot to me. I think coming into what I'll call Ray's world was a decision that took a while to make, actually, and I'll explain that more later, but that was very meaningful. Ray's world. I was in and out of Ray's world for over 40 years. Through my earlier experiences as a graduate student and also working with him in a variety of settings, I learned several things about Ray and the world he created. First, I learned that Ray was a master teacher and that he cared deeply for all the students, particularly the ones he worked with directly. I learned that in Ray's world, important things get done that enriched all those involved. And Ray was particularly passionate about positive change in a way that was contagious. I learned that in Ray's world, people are a company's most important asset, even more important than what it sells or than what it does. Finally, I learned that in Ray's world, everyone is treated as an equal with dignity and respect, no matter what their status or position. But I learned the most about Ray's world after he was APA president. Sandy had mentioned that he gave me a call. Well, he actually talked with me before that. He invited me to come do a workshop at the University of Tennessee for his students. And the evening after the presentation, Ray and I were sipping drinks in his jacuzzi. By the way, I should have known he was getting me comfortable for a reason. And Ray began talking about an idea he was considering. He said he was thinking about applying for the CEO position at APA. And he said, you know, that position is really two jobs. One job is working with the staff and overseeing day-to-day operations. And a second job is working with the complexities of APA's governance and all the stuff that goes on outside. Sounds like a good analysis, I said innocently. It was very innocent at the time. he said, the job of working with staff is going to be very demanding. It's going to be very time-consuming. And it's one that essentially is going to be working and helping try to manage over 300 people. Oh, and by the way, APA may be several million dollars in debt. We also have a massive turnover of staff. And I said, you know, wow, only a fool would take that job. Ray continued. He said, if I become CEO, I want to create the job of deputy CEO to work with staff and central office, and I want you to take that job. Oh, when does this fool start? I said. Ray added, I also plan to hire Jack McKay. And I said, who the hell is Jack McKay? And he said, Jack is the one that's going to keep APA from going bankrupt. And he did. Really, he done more than that. Those of us lucky enough to come into Ray's world know that Ray loved psychology and he loved APA even more. His goal was to take a potentially bankrupt association and a deteriorating central office and make it to a company that was financially stable and also had a stable and happy workforce. Because of what Ray started, APA has achieved that goal. When Ray took over, the total budget was about $30 million, and they were running deficits almost every year. We now have a budget of $115 million. In many years, we run a substantial surplus due to some things that Jack set up. When Ray became CEO, we were in space rented from the National Restaurant Association. We now own two buildings with a net equity of almost $190 million. When Ray took over, we had 300 staff, and it was dwindling. We now have 630 staff positions and a turnover rate which hovers around 10%, which is any of you who are his employer would love to have that kind of turnover rate. Ray was my mentor, my role model, a colleague, and a friend. To me, Ray was one of the greatest assets that APA's ever had. And even though I missed Ray in many ways when he left, I must say I regularly see Ray in everything that we have and everything that we do. I caught the contagious enthusiasm he had to make APA thrive. And it was this enthusiasm and dedication that made me decide I was up here on a 2-year leave of absence, by the way, and I've been here 25 and a half years. It made me decide that, you know, I'm not going back to academia. This is where I'm going to belong. I'm going to join Ray's journey and become part of his world. In closing, one of the things most of us know about Ray is the only thing that he loved more than APA was his family. He always beamed when they would come up in conversations, and you could tell he loved them very dearly and was very proud of who they were and everything they did. Ray, thank you for everything you've done for those lucky enough to come into your world. You will always be with us.
We used to love to talk about Mike's management style. He called it walk-around management because Mike was always walking around to the other various offices and checking on people and saying, how are you doing? You know, what's happening? And so it's his walk-around management style, which I don't think has ever hit the organizational psych books, which is unfortunate because it's a great style. I also need to say that when I was introducing family, I missed my brother. My brother is in the back row. If he'd been in the front row, he would have been introduced immediately. Larry Freer, could you stand, please, for a moment so they can see? Larry is a physician in Hanover, Pennsylvania, and his lovely wife. Gail is a critical care nurse in Hanover. Norman?
Sure. Thank you. Next, we're here from Mr. Jack McKay, former APA Chief Financial Officer.
I hope everybody can hear me, because I couldn't hear half of what's going on so far. Losing it. I've done a few of these now that I've gotten older, and this time I decided to write down some things, because every time I've done it, my wife would always say, why didn't you say this? Why didn't you say that? You left this out. So I'm learning fast. One of the reasons that Ray made this such a great place to be and to work and to be so close to everyone. And I think Gary can check me out on this, but I don't believe before Ray came, we ever had a CEO here that was here more than 5 years, ever. And Ray set a new standard, which Norman thankfully is continuing, because when someone comes in and out every 5 years who is leading the band, it's very difficult to grow an organization, I think, that people enjoy being with. So I think that's one of the reasons why we all feel so close to Ray. Even though he isn't here, he's here. Believe me, I think about him all the time. And we've had some rough and tumbles. As the CFO, most of the time, people don't like what you do and say. But Ray understood that and was very supportive of me the entire time I was here. I've known Ray and worked with him for more than 30 years. I started here when I was 12. When Ray was elected as treasurer in 1983, APA was entrenched in the purchasing of Psychology Today, which Ray opposed but was outvoted by the board and the council, and eventually APA bought the magazine. That purchase came with me losing a job, getting fired the day after that was purchased. It was fraught with heavy politics here at APA at the time, and I told Ray and the board at the time that my guess would be 5, 6, 7 years that APA would be close to bankruptcy unless the magazine publication was drastically changed and the management of that was drastically changed. Well, because it was fraught with politics, that never happened. And despite Ray's best efforts, by the end of the 1980s, the magazine had to be sold. And it was sold in spite of Ray's efforts, because it really drained APA of most of its assets at that time. Immediately after the sale, Ray called me at Humra, where I'd been the CFO since I left here for 6 years. And that's when I got to know Sandy, because Ray and Sandy took my wife Roberta and I out to dinner and tried to talk us into coming back to APA after having been fired with three little kids. So Roberta answered for me. And Sandy will remember, she said, "No way, no how are you going back to APA?" Ray does not like to lose. And after three dinners with Sandy and Ray and many hours with Roberta, I decided to come back to APA, which was really, for me, a smart decision. And Ray and I did lots of things that turned APA around. The first thing that we did when I came back was we fired a lot of expensive consultants that were hired for building development. What they were doing, we have no idea. We also fired a few staff people, and immediately were lucky enough to work a relationship with Trammell Crow, the Bank of America, and APA. And we developed this building that we're sitting in today. Not where you're sitting, because we couldn't do that then. But this building was developed. APA, as Mike said earlier, we ran the operation with surpluses for 6 or 7 years. Ray was not happy with just owning a part of this building. He wanted to own all the building. So in 1995, we bought out the interests of all the other parties, and APA owned this building outright. He still wasn't satisfied. He said, "If we can do that here, why can't we do it across the street?" So we bought the interests of the National Association of Social Workers and built the building at 10G. So Ray was really into expanding APA and making it financially very sound. And the deals we made were really unbelievable on today's standards. So we were able to turn this thing around, and I think Mike said by the time Ray left, I think when 1989 or 90, when I came back in here, I believe the net worth is somewhere around $7 million on an $80 million operation, not very much. When Ray left, I think our net worth is probably, I don't know, what did you say, Mike, $130 million, something like that. It's worth a lot. These two buildings are worth a lot of money. And it's all due to Ray's insistence, the board support, the council support, and the staff supporting all the things that we tried to do, and some of them weren't very easy. One story that I want to tell you about with Ray, this was in about 1995. I told Ray, I said, Ray, you know, we're going to have to change. Roberta doesn't want to hear this story, by the way. We're going to have to. When I was rehired in 1990, I hired an accountant and a lawyer to write an employment contract, which Ray was happy to accept, and so was the board and everybody else. So about 4 or 5 years into it, I went to Ray and said, Ray, we're going to have to change my contract. He said, well, why? I said, because the way it's written, in about 2 years, I'm going to be making more than you are. Ray looks at me and he says, a contract's a contract. Well, we changed the contract, fortunately. But that's the kind of a guy Ray was. He said a deal was a deal, and we were happy to have you back, and that's the way it is, and let's move on and talk about something else. And that's the way he ran the company. He was very much on top of things, knew what he was doing from a business perspective, and gave me complete and total support while I was here. So I cannot say more about my relationship with Ray and what he did for APA. And I don't think anybody thought more of APA and loved APA more than Ray did. I mean, in every way that, you know, he could, he did whatever he could to make sure that we're in this building, we own the other building, we're financially stable, and he put this whole thing together in his own way. He was very quiet. You know, Ray never got, I never heard Ray ever raise his voice. He's always calm, cool, and collected. But in his head, he knew exactly what he wanted to do and knew how to get me to do it. So my relationship with Ray was really marvelous, and I can't say enough about Ray. I want to end by, since Ray was such an avid runner and rollerblader, which he later turned into some broken legs or knees or some such thing, and I'd like to end my tribute with to Ray with a eulogy of a sportsman by Grantland Rice. When one great scorer comes to write against your name, he marks not that you won or lost, but how you played the game. And to me, that's Ray Fowler. And I miss him. God bless him. And I wish he were here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Next, we'll be hearing from Mrs. Judy Strasburger Fox, former APA Executive Director for Governance Affairs.
It's nice to see so many old friends. Can you hear me? Okay, down a little more, like that. Okay, one thing I'm going to pay tribute to Ray, I'm going to say that I'm not going to bitch about the weather today. This was his kind of weather, and it wasn't mine, and that's the thing we most disagreed on all the years that we worked together. Anyway, first I want to thank Sandy for so graciously sharing Ray with us for so many years and making it a family thing instead of just a boss and employees, that sort of thing. I knew Ray and worked with him for a quarter of my life, first as a board member, then treasurer, then APA president, and finally CEO. And I remember the day that the board chose Ray, and I was just so elated. And that hadn't always been the case in some previous choices of the board. So that made it extra special. But there's so many memories that come to mind when I think of this building and Ray. And I remember when it was completed and we walked into the new boardroom then, which is now the old boardroom, obviously. We looked at the table and we just said, oh my God, what did we do? It looked like the Queen Elizabeth had docked. And it was like, and then just like that, it filled up and we were out of space, but it was just amazing. And another memory is, I'm talking about Sandy, and he'd say, Sandy went shopping, and he'd say, you know, when she came home, I'd say, now that's a Sandy outfit. And it was just so sweet to just hear him talk about his wife that way, and whatever, just special moments. So he was my mentor, my friend, my colleague, and he always had my back, and I knew that. And he always had the board's back, and he always had APA's back. Nothing was too big or small to get his attention. Whether it was squaring the circle for a presidential paper or moving APA forward to meet the demands of the moment, he did this all in Ray fashion, and I got, and no, not many people got to see it as close up as I did on a daily basis. Our trust in each other was truly one of the most remarkable things I've experienced, and I will always be indebted with much fondness for him for making those years of my life so pleasant, so challenging, and so rewarding. And he will be remembered. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. And I should also say that this is the first time using the technology in this room that will allow us to actually record this event. So hopefully we'll be able to distribute this to others who are not here. Our next speaker is Dr. Nadine Caslow, the 2014 president of APA.
Well, good afternoon, and welcome to all of you. It's lovely to see so many members of Ray's family here. And it's really quite an honor, Sandy, that you invited me to speak today. There's no question that for most past presidents of APA, the highlight of their year is the APA convention. And that was certainly true for me. But one of the greatest highlights of the convention was that Ray was there. And he came when we gave the Raymond Fowler Award to Melba Vasquez. He was in the room. He and Sandy were there. There's a wonderful picture that's been rotating around of Ray and Norman and I at my presidential party. And I remember Norman saying to me after he saw this picture, he knew who we were. But for me, the highlight was at my opening session when Ray stood up, when I asked Ray to stand. And everybody applauded for him. And he understood. So somebody asked me earlier today how I met Ray, because I think I'm probably the only person speaking other than you who wasn't part of his world when he was CEO here. And actually, I met Ray through the Psychology Executive Roundtable when I was there representing a different organization. Actually, I was there representing APIC. And I don't remember if it was the first or second year that I was there. Ray was going through one of those very stressful times with APA. And he kept walking in and out of the room, and he was getting increasingly stressed out. And I kind of went up to him afterwards, and he just said it was a very difficult situation. And that night we had dinner together, and Sandy was there. And I remember just a few things about my first dinner with Ray. I decided that the reason he liked me is that Sandy and I showed up in the same outfit.
Oh, wow.
So I actually really think that's really the only reason. No, seriously. So we showed up in the same outfit, and we never did that again, but we have many of the same clothes. We just make sure not to wear them at the same time. But Ray talked that night about the fact that he had two major roles as CEO. One was to support the president, and the other one was to protect the organization. And I think that he really understood both of those roles. I was looking back at old monitors today, and I was surprised to see that when he retired, they asked for a quote from me. And I want to read you part of that quote because I said it better then than I could say it now. While participating in meetings with Ray, such as the Psychology Executive Roundtable, I and others consistently have been impressed by his quiet and unassuming manner, which belies the breadth and depth of his knowledge. His astute insights, his vision, and the fact that he is a true Renaissance person. Ray was the consummate statesperson for our profession. So I've thought a lot about, well, why did we connect? Well, I think a lot of it was that we had many shared values. One of the most important things that Ray did was help create APAGS. And I know that Nabil, I saw, was here today. That Ray and I really shared a passion about students, and I know that he understood that students were not just our future, but that students were also our present. We also shared a passion for exercise, as you already mentioned, for running and me for dance. But he was really the first person within organized psychology that gave me permission to acknowledge that I still danced, even though I was a psychologist, and that was really important to me. We also shared this passion for healthy eating, which would absolutely drive the wait staff nuts. Because we would say, we'll order this, but hold this, 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 and this, and then we would end up with the identical meal. But we never said, we'll just take two of those. And as Mike said, it was his passion and love for psychology and APA that I think that's something that we shared. Many people have already talked about Ray as a mentor, and there's no question that he was a mentor to me. So one of my fondest memories of Ray as a mentor was one evening at an APA convention. I was it was either Marty Seligman or Phil Zimbardo's suite when they were president, but I think it was Marty's. And it was Ray and Marty and Phil and Stan Brodsky and me. I don't really know how I got invited. Anyhow, they were talking about the history of psychology. And I learned more that night about the history of psychology than I had learned in any course. And for the first time in my life, they got me interested in it. And it was the history of psychology in the U.S., but also the history of psychology internationally, because he was truly passionate about psychology internationally. At the beginning of today, Norman showed that clip that was shown at ICAP last year, but what wasn't shown in the clip was when that was shown in Paris, there was a standing ovation that didn't stop. And that's the other part of that clip. So I guess I didn't realize some of the time when Ray was mentoring me, because I ended up at this meeting in APA in the early 2000s. And I was called to this breakfast meeting. I was pretty new on the scene, and I had no idea why I was invited to this meeting. And it was called a science pipeline meeting. And I get to this meeting, and I stay there for an hour, and I still didn't understand why I was invited to that meeting. And at the end of the meeting, I went up to Ray, and I said, what was this meeting all about? And he said, well, there's a practice pipeline meeting to get practice people to run for president, and they're starting a science pipeline meeting. I said, oh. Why was I invited? And he said, because you're in the pipeline to run for president. And I looked at him and I said, I will never run for president of APA. He said, yes, you will. But the part about Ray, and I think the reason I'm here today, is because of our friendship. We were there for each other through really tough times. I had some health problems. Earlier in my life, and it was a really difficult time for me. And that's when I first became friends with Ray and Sandy. And they were really supportive to me during that time. But when Ray got sick, when he was CEO, he called me up and asked me for help getting him hooked up with services with a consultation at NIH. And it meant a lot to me that he trusted me in that way. But maybe the hardest, the most powerful time was, as many of you who know me know, I was in a very serious accident where I killed someone on a motorcycle. And I wasn't sure I could ever show up at a psychology meeting again. And I told Ray and Sandy about it one night. And the next morning, Ray came to me and he said, I couldn't sleep. And you said that too. We couldn't sleep. And he said to me, don't ever stay home. It was just an accident. And you belong in psychology. And he was the reason I stayed in organized psychology. And he encouraged me to write a paper that I wrote anonymously about it as a way to cope with it. And it was because of him I was able to heal. And so we were there for each other through tough times, and I appreciate that. But the most important thing was spending time with Ray and Sandy together and socializing with them, because that really helped me and all of us appreciate the depth of their love for each other. And Ray's willingness to not only go above and beyond the call of duty for APA and psychology nationally and internationally, but also for his family. We all loved him.
Thanks. Great. Thank you, Nadine. Next, we'll hear from Dr. Ron Fox, the 1994 president of APA.
Thank you. Can you hear me all right? I don't know if you've noticed, but folks my age, when they get a podium like this, often you see them kind of, they get a stare, and they set their mind in gear and let it sort of wander around the universe, I guess in hopes that it might bump into an idea or a thought worth worth repeating. Thank heavens I did that earlier. So today I can just get right to the message. Ray had a remarkable career, of course, and I'm not going to try to repeat and go into all that. Others have done it and are doing it better. But I think we've all heard the expression, I think, that a person is known by the mark that they leave on others. And so I want to talk a little bit about the thing that he left in the minds and hearts of others. For me personally, he was a friend and a mentor, a colleague, and a co-conspirator, if you will, in a lot of APA campaigns and elections. I would not have been president of APA, but not for him. I ran once, I lost, I did my best, I was ready to move on, and I had. And then when the next cycle was running around, we had dinner. you hear a theme here? and then he followed that up with a phone call, and I decided to run again, and I'm really glad that I did. But I wouldn't have done it without him and with my wife, Margaret, at the time. And they were about equal in that. He urged me and others to seek office, but not just to have it, but to do something with it. What do you want to do? What ideas do you have? What do you want to accomplish? Those were things that he didn't grill you about, but they came up and you talked about and so on. And I saw him doing the same thing, and he always seemed to have things to accomplish. Mostly they were good things, as far as I knew. He was also a role model for a less confrontational style, which sometimes I could use. I think in dealing from others, he was very good at it. He was a member, some people forget, that he was a member of the so-called Dirty Dozen. For old APA people, this was a group of dedicated, energetic, bright, cantankerous, sharp elbow type people who were all in the practitioner community, who were determined over a period of about 3 decades and did to change the face of psychology to better represent the interest of practitioners. They generated a number of presidents of APA and so on and so forth. Ray was the only one in that group, which was 14, not 12. They couldn't count. But at any rate, he was the only one in that group that people on both sides, and there were a lot of arguments, really trusted and would listen to and talk to. That says something. He was a natural diplomat, in my view. And remember, the idea, the definition of a diplomat is the kind of person that can tell you to go to hell in such a way that you almost look forward to the trip. And I think he had some of that in him, and it came naturally. He was a good psychologist. He showed us over and over, by the way he did things, that our stuff works. It really is good to listen, to be non-judgmental in your discussions, and to bring antagonists and dissidents together to see if we couldn't do something that was for the better good and that did least harm to APA. I think he did that. I think he was good at it. And I think if some of us had followed his example more closely, some of our later disputes and aggravations and arguments with each other would come at a far less cost in terms of personnel and financial resources. I believe that. He had a lifetime love affair with APA, and he shared her with many of the others of us who also developed a love affair with APA. He did good works for our association, and I will miss him. I will miss him a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ron. I'm going to read now a brief tribute from someone who was supposed to be here, but had to have emergency surgery, Dr. Marty Seligman. The what year was Marty? I have it here somewhere. Marty was the 1998 president of APA. Ray Fowler's death is a grievous loss to psychology, to positive psychology, and to me personally. Ray changed my life in a small way and in a big way. The small way. He gave a lecture in Australia at the Geelong Grammar School, where we were moving the school toward positive education. The lecture was about walking 10,000 steps every day. It was typically low key. We yawned a bit, but all of us bought pedometers the next day. Ray was quiet and compellingly persuasive. I have walked about 10,000 steps every day since, and I think of Ray every time I look at my pedometer. The big way. When I was president of APA, the director of NIMH said he would give APA $40 million to work on evidence-based therapy. I went to CAP, one of our governance groups, to persuade them, but their chair said, what if the evidence doesn't come out in our favor? He then told me that I was in deep doo-doo. I went to Ray for advice. He told me that I was not cut out to be a transactional leader. I would have to become a transformational president. This was how positive psychology started. After his APA days, Ray found a new career, at least his fourth, in positive psychology. He became a teacher of positive health. He taught the psychological benefits of exercise, and he acquired more than 100 devoted graduate students. He pedometrized all of us. That is, he taught all of us to use pedometers. I miss him greatly. He was my cherished mentor, and he was my good friend, from Dr. Martin Seligman. Thank you, Marty. Next, we have a tribute from Dr. Don Friedheim, a clinical psychologist and a longtime friend of Ray.
Thank you, Norm. Percy Blythe Shelley wrote, "Music, when soft voices die, vibrates in the memory." I well remember Ray's soft voice, even in situations of great tension during council representative meetings. But what I remember most about Ray is his infectious smile, been referred to by Norm as well. On many occasions at those hectic conventions, I would see Ray coming down a hallway, obviously racing toward yet another meeting. And when we saw each other, he would break out into that huge smile and say as we passed, "Got to run." We would shake hands and go on to our obligations, but the contact and his smile were all that I needed. My brother lives in La Jolla, and over the past 5 years, Gerda and I were fortunate to visit Ray and Sandy several times in their home. Despite the difficulties in communication, there was always that wonderful smile and his sincere interest in hearing whatever we discussed. Through those last years, we saw Sandy and Ray as no other couple we've ever known. Their devotion to each other and Sandy's patience and caring is an enduring inspiration to both of us. Thank you very much.
We were supposed to hear from another speaker, Dr. Janelle Gauthier, who's the current president of the International Association of Applied Psychology, but had an illness in the family and is not able to be here. So next we will hear from Karen Fowler, daughter and firstborn Ray.
So all of my life, people have asked me what it was like to be raised by psychologists. My response was always, "I'm not that different from everyone else." But now that I'm grown up and have my own 18-year-old son, I realize our upbringing was not typical at all. Let me share a few examples. So contrary to legend among the graduate students at the university, we were not raised in a Skinner box, but when we were being potty trained, our father decided to use operant conditioning techniques. An independent bowel movement resulted in a handful of M&Ms. Unfortunately for my folks, I was the true daughter of psychologists. You know, I was named after Karen Horney. While they were shaping my behavior, I was shaping theirs. Most kids' requests for candy right before dinner are flatly denied. Not me. I knew a trip to the bathroom would get me exactly what I wanted. So speaking of supper, we never knew what to expect at meals. Dad wanted to desensitize us to eating weird food. Just because it looked different, it still tasted good. So when we got to the table, we never knew if the milk was going to be blue, the tomato soup was going to be purple, or the mashed potatoes were going to be red. He just wanted us to be comfortable with different foods. Even though they look weird, they tasted good. So again, these were not perfectly controlled experiments, and this one backfired in two ways. One was, for a long time, I wouldn't eat mashed potatoes unless they were red. And the other was on a trip to Mexico with family friends. My youngest brother, Michael, was about 4, and we were out to dinner, and we were having the local delicacy of roast goat, and they called it roast kid. So after we polished off the first plate, Michael said, "Hey, that roast child was good. Can we have some more?" Our father was both horrified and delighted. Delighted that we would eat anything, and horrified that Michael was happily willing to be a cannibal since it tasted so good. So as you know, we were raised in the Bible Belt of Alabama. And as you might also know, our father was decidedly non-religious. As a matter of fact, he detested Christmas. I'm not sure if it was because of the religious emphasis that was put on it, the commercialism of it, or just because it was gray and cold. For whatever reason, he started a Fowler tradition. So every year at Christmas time, we packed up the Volkswagen camper and we drove to Key West. And we camped on the beach for Christmas. We'd make yarn and aluminum foil ornaments on the way down there and decorate a scrub pine that we would cut out of the woods. We'd swim and play all day in the sun and sit by a beach bonfire at night. Those are some of my fondest memories. Another difference in parenting I experienced with my dad was when I decided to go skydiving. I'd been dating the president of the skydiving club at the University of Alabama. I never asked my dad's permission to jump because I knew what the answer was going to be. So I waited till I turned 18 and signed my own release and went through the training. Took lessons and was prepared for my first jump. Dad, of course, was out of town on some APA business, I'm sure. He came home and I called a family conference to tell him my plans to jump. Most fathers would yell and cuss, but my dad just walked out of the house in a daze into the backyard. Next thing I knew, we heard a big splash, and he, in his frustration or his, you know, shock, had walked into the swimming pool. So he came back in. After he dried off and changed clothes, we sat back down, and he calmly made me a deal. I've been hearing about these deals he makes. There's a pattern here. If I would postpone my jump, he would accompany me to the drop zone, and he would talk with all the jumpers and let them explain to him how safe this activity was. And when he was convinced that it was safe, he would give his blessings to me. So I agreed, and we went the next day to the tiny little airport where they all jumped. As Dad asked his questions and we listened to the answers, we both became convinced it was not the right thing for me to do. If he had demanded that I not jump, I surely would have done it. Instead, I was able to see through his eyes the fear that he felt for his only daughter. To describe our father as calm and not overreactive is an understatement. One of our favorite stories about Dad happened when Mom was out of town and we were left in the care of Dad. It was against the rules for the boys, my brothers, to ride motorcycles. But you know about boys and rules. They were in the local field riding motorcycles when Deck and Mike collided. They were both hurt pretty badly and limped home. They lied and told Dad that they had been in a bicycle accident and that they needed to go to the emergency room, that they were hurt pretty badly. Dad didn't think a bike wreck in the neighborhood could have been that serious, so he said if they were still in pain the next morning, he would take them to the doctor. So the next day's trip to the doctor revealed that Deck had a concussion and a broken arm, and Michael had broken his foot in numerous places. So they both left with casts, much to our mother's dismay when she came home. So the last story I'll share with you has the most meaning for me. When my mom died in 1992, she and I had been planning a trip to Alaska. A few years later, when I was visiting with Dad, he offered to take me on that dream trip to Alaska. Knowing my love of the outdoors, he planned an incredible adventure, a tent and cabin safari. And even though it was not her cup of tea, Sandy was a good sport and went along with us. This was 1993 and I was 36. Prior to that trip, I had come to the conclusion that I was not going to have children. And that was okay. But while we were exploring the wilds of Alaska, I was touched by the joy my father had watching me on the vacation of a lifetime. And I decided then that I truly wanted to be able to experience the world through the eyes of a cherished child, as my dad was doing. As he and I were hiking up Cottonwood Mountain, we stopped for a rest on a moss-covered boulder. I told him I had decided to have a baby. With surprise, he said, "You don't even have a steady boyfriend." I said, "We have the technology." He was so excited, and he pledged to support me in every way. I returned from that trip with a plan to become a single mother by choice, and in 1996, my incredible son, Cade, was born. True to his word, my dad lovingly supported us by being the best dad and grandfather we could have ever asked for. So the sometimes unconventional parenting that I received taught me these lessons. Change is good. Take risk, but be reasonable. Love unconditionally. Seek first to understand, then to be understood. And experiences are far more important than possessions. I'll remember my father for many things. I'll remember him as a wonderful father to my brothers and me as we were growing up. I'll remember how he added to the richness of our family by the relationships he had with colleagues, graduate students, and friends. I will remember his love of psychology and the many contributions that he made to the field. I'll remember with pride the national and international reputation he built. But the thing I will remember the most is the last 4 years after his stroke. He handled the devastating limitations of suddenly not being able to speak, read, or write with an incredible amount of dignity and humor and patience. In his inability to speak, he showed me more love than I could have ever imagined. The way his whole being lit up every time he saw me. The way he would kiss my hand and say, love, love, love. I spent more undivided time with him post-stroke, caring for him, and loving on him more than ever before. And for that, I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. So now we're at the part of the program where we're finished with the planned remarks, and now it's your turn. Anyone who would like to say anything about Ray, you're free to do it now. Sandy said you could come up here. If you're not comfortable up here, you can speak from where you are. So this is the bubble up time. Anything that bubbles up from the group, all will be happy for you to share it. And yes.
I saw Florence Denmark, a former president of APA, a few weeks ago, and she wanted me to say a few words, if you don't mind. She's in Seattle for a graduation. She was on the board of directors with Ray and wrote, Ray was kind, conscientious, generous, very intelligent. He was well-liked, well-respected, and devoted to his family and friends. Ray was active in Psy-Chi at the same time I was, which is when we first met. While I was no longer on the board when he was president, I remained friends with him and Sandy throughout the years. One of my favorite memories is our trip to China, which Ray arranged. I'll always remember him as the epitome of a dedicated leader, and we'll miss him. That's from Florence, Denmark. Thank you.
I want to thank everyone for the really moving and large tributes to Ray. And I'd like to say a couple of words about his vision and his stature internationally. Ray had a vision for APA in the world, and he exercised it in many ways. He organized trips, he founded the Office of International Affairs, and he attended, I think, probably every international congress and many regional congresses. And when he did that, he presented APA as a welcoming place that wanted to be a partner in the development of psychology around the world. And I'll just end with, I was struck after his death when condolences from many people around the world started flooding into APA. Many of them were from leaders of psychology organizations in many countries around the world. And I was struck by how many of them said, you know, Ray was the person who helped us think about organizing and developing psychology in our country. And he was the person who was there to help support us in the very hard work of building and starting our associations. So his legacy is not just around us all here, it's actually everywhere. Thank you.
Well, first off, I have been pedomadized by Ray and Sandy, and don't leave home without it. I have so many warm memories of Ray that starts back probably from the SEPA workshop days. And there's one from Egypt that Karen and Sandy and Monica are a part of. But I'm not going to do that one because I have a short amount of time. And I hail from Minnesota, so I have to do the MMPI taxi story. How many of you here know the MMPI taxi story? So Sandy does. I know it from about like 1,000 times repeated at MMPI workshops and symposium meetings. Ray was on his way to an MMPI symposium on St. Pete Beach, and I think he was on a red eye. I don't know if it was from La Jolla or someplace else in the world, but it was a red eye, and he was looking forward to the taxi ride from the Tampa airport to St. Pete Beach, which is about an hour, because he wanted to sleep. Well, Ray, being the southern gentleman that he was, could not tell the taxi driver, who was a chatty Cathy, that he wanted to sleep. So the taxi driver kept engaging him in a conversation, and all Ray wanted to do was sleep. And finally, the taxi driver says, well, what brings you to St. Pete Beach? He said, a convention. And Ray thought, oh, this is my opportunity to shut up the chatty Cathy taxi driver. When the taxi driver said, well, what's the meeting about? And Ray said, the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory. And the taxi driver repeated back to him, the MMPI, when are they ever going to revise that damn thing?
Ray Fowler liked to start things, and I'm grateful, among many of the others of you here, for having been part of something that he started. My name is James Powelski. I'm at the University of Pennsylvania, a colleague of Martin Seligman's in positive psychology. In fact, it was through Marty Seligman that I met Ray Fowler. Ray, of course, was enormously influential in the starting of positive psychology. I've heard Marty on numerous occasions say that Ray was the only mentor he's had for the last 30 years. I met Ray on the very first day of the Master of Applied Positive Psychology program that we started at Penn, and he talked about his love of starting things. A couple of years later, we were trying to figure out how to continue positive psychology, and he said, well, have you thought about starting an association? And we said, no. But of course, in his, not sure if dinner was involved with that one or not, but somehow he convinced us to start the International Positive Psychology Association. And I, knowing nothing about associations, was its first executive director. I have no idea how he had time to mentor all the rest of you, because I was always on the phone with him asking him questions. And no matter how distraught I was, no matter how big the problem was in my world, he would calmly tell me a story to begin with that kind of put things in perspective. We'd laugh a little bit, and then he'd help me to solve the problem. When my wife was in the hospital, our son had just been born. She caught an infection and was in the hospital for almost a week, got sepsis. It was very serious. Ray came by and was the only non-family member who visited Liam and Susie and me in the hospital. It was at the start of something, and it was wonderful to have him there. A couple of years later, we were visiting Ray and Sandy at their home in La Jolla, and I was excitedly telling them that I was going to be going to Africa because there was the first East African conference on psychology that was taking place, and I'd been asked to talk about positive psychology, only to find out that it was Ray who had started that initiative to have that meeting. And so I think about all these things that Ray started, all the things that are just in my world, and I am here with others who've experienced other parts of Ray's world, and I'm just amazed and so very grateful. And I think Ray was aptly named. I like to think of his name from a mathematical perspective. A ray is something that has a finite beginning, but then continues without end. Ray liked to start things at a finite time that then continued without end. And so many of us are part of things that he started at a particular time and are ongoing. And I think that's very fitting, a very fitting way to think about Ray, someone who began his life at a finite time, but whose existence is clearly ongoing. Thank you.
Any more comments? Okay. Well, again, thank you all for coming. I really appreciate all of the speakers and really everyone for showing up to honor Ray with your very presence in this place. And just to conclude the program, we have a very short video to show you, after which everyone can convene out in the foyer for a little more socializing or to beat the storm, either way.
Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, my oh my, what a wonderful day. Plenty of sunshine heads my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, Mr. Bluebird on my shoulder. It's the truth, it's actual, everything is satisfied. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, my oh my, what a wonderful day. Plenty of sunshine heads my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, Mr. Bluebird on my shoulder. It's the truth, it's actual, everything is satisfied.
All right, folks, let's go out and socialize a bit.